This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Appalachian English is American English native to the Appalachian region of the eastern United States. The term theoretically includes multiple varieties of English, predominantly including Western Pennsylvania English as spoken in northern Appalachia. However, most commonly, Appalachian English refers to Southern American English as spoken in central and southern Appalachia. The Atlas of North American English identifies the Inland South dialect region, in which Southern American English's defining vowel shift is the most evolved, as centering squarely in southern Appalachia, around the cities of Knoxville and Chattanooga, Tennessee, Birmingham, Alabama, and Asheville, North Carolina. Appalachian English can also refer to an older or more traditional southern Appalachian variety, from which this newer dialect developed. All Appalachian English is rhotic and characterized by distinct phonology, morphology, syntax, and lexicon. It is mostly oral but can also be written and appears in some known literary works. Appalachian English has long been criticized both within and outside of the speaking area as an inferior dialect, which is often mistakenly attributed to supposed laziness, lack of education, or the region's relative isolation. American writers throughout the 20th century have used the dialect as the chosen speech of uneducated and unsophisticated characters, though research has largely disproven these stereotypes. However, use of the Appalachian dialect is still often an impediment to educational and social advancement. Extensive research has been conducted since the 1930s to determine the origin of the Appalachian dialect. One theory is that the dialect is a remnant of Elizabethan or Shakespearean English, which had been preserved by the region's isolation. Recent research suggests that Appalachian English developed as a uniquely American dialect as early settlers re-adapted the English language to their unfamiliar frontier environment. This is supported by numerous similarities between the Appalachian dialect and colonial American English. Speakers of Appalachian English have no trouble understanding standard English, but even native speakers of other dialects can find it somewhat impenetrable. Compare the similar situation of Glasgow English and London English, and foreigners may have some trouble understanding it, while others may find it easier to comprehend. The characteristic syntax and morphology of Appalachian English gives way to more standard forms in schools, public speaking venues, and courts of law, but the phonology is likely to remain the same. Contents: 1 phonology, 11 phonetics, 12 phonemic incidents, 2 grammar, 21 conjugation of the verb to be, 22 conjugation among other verb types, 23 a verb ing also known as a prefixing, 24 other verb forms, 25 double nouns, 26 pronouns and demonstratives, 27 other grammatical forms, 271 lakita, 272 other, 3 lexicon, 31 colloquialisms, 4 origins, 5 see also, 6 sources, 7 notes, 8 external links. Phonology: this article contains IPA phonetic symbols without proper rendering support. You may see question marks, boxes, or other symbols instead of Unicode characters. Phonetics: the southern shift and southern drawl, a vowel shift known as the southern shift, which largely defines the speech of the southern United States, is the most developed both in Texas English and here in Appalachian English, located in a dialect region which the Atlas of North American English identifies as the Inland South. This involves several unique vowel changes, in 3 complex stages. Stage 1, in the diphthong, a, the second half of the diphthong is often omitted, and it is thus pronounced similar to thus. For example, the word tide in this dialect may sound to outsiders more like Todd or even Tad in extreme instances. Words such as wire, fire, tire, and retired are pronounced so as to sound completely identical to the words war, far, tar, and retard, respectively. Stage 2, the diphthong, e, begins further back and open in the mouth, so that, for example, fish bait and old lace in this dialect may sound to other English speakers more like fish bite and old lice. The vowel then moves in the opposite direction and acquires a drawl or longer, glide-like sound quality, so that red may be said to sound more like ray-ud or rihud. Stage 2 is most common in heavily stressed syllables. Stage 3, the vowel is pronounced higher in the mouth and with a drawl, so that hit may be said to sound like he. It conversely, the vowel I lowers and then glides up again, so that feet may sound more like fihet or fuheet. Stage 3 is most common in heavily stressed syllables. The word oil, which is pronounced in standard forms of English with 2 distinct vowels, almost like ayul, is pronounced instead as uhll, with the vowel part of the word pronounced like the vowel sound in book. Lax and tense vowels often neutralize before l, making pairs like feel, fill, and fail. Fell homophones for speakers. In some areas, some speakers may distinguish between the two sets of words by reversing the normal vowel sound, e.g., feel may sound like fill, and vice versa. Short I and short e have the same pronunciation when appearing before n or m, e.g., pen and pin are both pronounced pin. Adjectives are often used to distinguish between the two, e.g., ink pen. Words with o in the middle tend to be drawn. For example, the o in home becomes home or ha-ome. This drawing of the o is common in southern Ohio and Pennsylvania, and may occur in regions bordering western Appalachia. Phonemic incidence research suggests that the Appalachian dialect is one of the most distinctive and divergent dialects within the United States. An intrusive R occurs in some words such as wash, leading to the pronunciation W. An R sound is often used for long O at the end of a word. For example, hollow, a small, sheltered valley, is pronounced holler, homophonous with holler. Other examples are potato, pronounced tater, tomato, pronounced mater, and tobacco, pronounced backer. H retention occurs at the beginning of certain words. It, in particular, is pronounced hit at the beginning of a sentence, and also when emphasized. The word ain't is pronounced haint. Participles and gerunds such as doing and mining end in n instead of. While this occurs to some extent in all dialects of American English, it possibly occurs with greater frequency in Southern Appalachia. Word final a is sometimes pronounced I, as in okra, oki. Intervocalic s in greasy is pronounced z, as in other Southern American and some British speech. A related matter, the noun grease is pronounced with an s, but this consonant turns into a z in the adjective and in the verb to grease. People who live in the Appalachian dialect area or elsewhere in the South pronounce the word Appalachia with a short a sound, as in latch in the third syllable, eplat, or eplati, while those who live outside of the Appalachian dialect area or at its outer edges tend to pronounce it with a long a sound, as in lay, epli. Grammar conjugation of the verb to be. The conjugation of the verb to be is different from that of Standard English in several ways, and there is sometimes more than one form of the verb to be acceptable in Appalachian English. Divergence from Standard English conjugation of the verb to be occurs with the highest frequency in the past tense, where grammatically plural subjects also take the singular form was rather than were. Thus, the paradigm of the verb to be in Appalachian English more closely resembles the paradigm for other non-be verbs in English, where the past tense takes a single form, regardless of number or person. The use of the word ain't is also one of the most salient features of this dialect. While ain't is used to some extent in most American English dialects, it is used with much greater frequency in the Appalachian dialect conjugation among other verb types, while the greatest amount of divergence in subject-verb concord occurs in the past tense of the verb to be. Certain types of plural subjects have an effect on concord across various types of verbs. However, plural subjects continue to show the greatest frequency of non-concord. The example below is taken from Wolfram and Christian, conjoined noun phrases, me and my sister gets into a fight sometimes. A boy and his daddy was a huntin', collective noun phrases, some people makes it from fat off a pig. People's not concerned. Other plural noun phrases, no matter what their parents has taught them, the cars was all tore up, expletive there, there's different breeds of them, there was five in our family. A verb ing, also known as a prefixing, a notable feature of Appalachian English is the a prefix, which occurs with participle forms ending in ing. This prefix is pronounced as a schwa. The a prefix most commonly occurs with progressives, in both past and non-past tenses. For example, my cousin had a little pony and we was a riding it one day. Common contexts also include where the participle form functions as an adverbial complement, such as after movement verbs come, go, take off, and with verbs of continuing or starting, keep, start, get to. An example of each being, all of a sudden a bear come a runnin', and he just kep a beggin'. However, the a prefix may not be attached to a verb which begins with a relatively unstressed syllable, such as discover or retire. While much less frequent or productive, the a prefix can also occur on participles ending in ed, such as a haunted. The a prefix has been found to occur most frequently in more animated or vivid narratives, as a stylistic device. Wolfram used in formal and educated writing in the 17th century, it became non-standard in the 18th century. Other verb forms, sometimes the past participle of a strong verb such as do, is used in place of the past tense. For example, I done it already instead of I did it already, or in the case of the verb see, I seen instead of I saw. Went is often used instead of gone as the past participle of the verb to go. She had went to Ashland less frequently. Gone is used as the simple past tense I gone down to the meeting, but wasn't nobody there. Done is used with the past tense or a past participle commonly used as a past tense, such as gone to express action just completed, as in, I done went, gone to the store. Some English strong verbs are occasionally conjugated as weak verbs in Appalachian English, e.g., knowed, and seed. The construction don't know is used with transitive verbs to indicate the negative, e.g., he don't know no better. This is commonly referred to as the double negative, and is either negative or emphatically negative. Never positive, none, is often used in place of any, as in, I don't have none. Verb forms for the verb to lay are used instead of forms of the verb to lie. For example, lay down and hush. Might could is sometimes used where a speaker of standard English would say, might be able to or could maybe. Measurements such as foot and mile often retain their singular form even when used in the plural sense. For example, that stick is 3 foot long, or we need 6 foot of drywall. Foot in the singular is standard in UK English double nouns. Some nouns are spoken in pairs, the first noun describing the seemingly redundant second noun, as in pound dog, Cadillac car, widow woman, toad frog, biscuit bread, or rifle gun. Pronouns and demonstratives them is sometimes used in place of those as a demonstrative in both nominative and oblique constructions. Examples are them are the pants I want and give me some of them crackers. Oblique forms of the personal pronouns are used as nominative when more than one is used. Cf. French moi et toi. For example, me and him are real good friends instead of he and I are really good friends. Accusative case personal pronouns are used as reflexives in situations which, in American English, do not typically demand them, e.g., I'm gonna get me a haircut. The self, selves forms are used almost exclusively as emphatics, and then often in non-standard forms, e.g., the preacher himself. Second person pronouns are often retained as subjects in imperative sentences, e.g., you go and get you a cookie. Other grammatical forms lakita in Appalachian English, the form lakita functions as an adverb and occurs before the past form of a verb lakita carries a meaning similar to on the verge of or came so close that I really thought X would, where X is the subject of the verb. It also serves as an intensifier. For example, I lakita never went to sleep last night. And I knew what I'd done and boy it lakita scared me to death. Lakita also imposes a notion of counterfactuality on the clause in which it appears, distinguishing it from the word almost. For example, you could say they almost made it to the top of the mountain, but they lakita made it to the top of the mountain would be incorrect. Lakita does not carry the same notion of partial truth as almost. Other pronouns and adjectives are sometimes combined with un meaning one, such as youngin to mean child, bigon to mean big one, and youins to mean you all. Youngin and biggin also are commonplace in northern UK vernacular English. The word element ever is sometimes reversed in words such as whatever, ever what, whoever, everwo, and however, everhow, but the usage remains the same, e.g., everwo did this as in big trouble. The word right can be used with adjectives, e.g., a right cold morning, and along with its standard use with adverbs can also be used with adverbs of manner and time, e.g., right loud or right often. This is an acceptable formation in some areas of UK English. Citation needed. Lexicon. The Appalachian dialect is part of the Greater Southern Dialects in its relation to south of the Midland. It has several terms in common with its North Midland counterpart, including poke paper bag, hull to shell, and blinds shutters. Certain German-derived words such as smearcase cottage cheese, however, are present in the North Midland dialect but absent in the Appalachian dialect. The following is a list of words which occur in the Appalachian dialect. These words are not exclusive to the region, but tend to occur with greater frequency than in other English dialects. Afeard, afraid, airish, cool or chilly. Airy, any bald, na treeless mountain summit. See Appalachian balds. Ball hoot, v to drive recklessly fast on dangerous rural or mountain roads, derived from an old logging term for rolling or skidding logs downhill. Blinds, n window shades or window shutters. While blinds usually refers to window shades, in Appalachia and the Greater Midland dialect, it can also refer to window shutters. Blinked, sour, rotten. Boomer, small red squirrel. Brickle, brittle caps, popcorn. Cat head, a large biscuit. Chancy, doubtful. Chaw, a wad of chewing tobacco. Clean, verb modifier which is used to mean entirely completing an action can be used in place of all the way, e.g., he knocked it clean off the table. Coke, short for Coca-Cola, but applied to all flavored, carbonated sodas, regardless of brand, flavor or type. Coke is used primarily in the southern half of the dialect region, whereas pop receives more usage in southern Ohio, eastern Kentucky, West Virginia and most of Southwest Virginia cornpone, skillet cornbread made without eggs counterpane, bedspread cove, a valley between two ridges discomfit, v inconvenience directly, later, after a while, when it becomes convenient, soon, immediately largely depending on context dope, end soda fireboard, mantle fit, used in place of the word fought fixin', a serving or helping of food can I get a fixin' of dumplings, an event, party or social function where food is served they're having a fixin' at church next Friday about to, they're fixin' to get hitched gom, end mess gom, also used as a transitive verb, to gum up, i.e., to mess up. Flannel cake, pancake. Haint, used in the context of ghost or spirit, not the derivation of ain't, holler, and hollow, as in a valley between two hills, e.g., I continue to travel between hollers and cities, hull, v. shell, as in to shell beans ill, bad-tempered jacket, n. vest jarfly, cicada jasper, n. acquaintance kyarn, carrion dead flesh, such as roadkill that smells like kyarn kindly, kind of, sort of, e.g., just kindly give it a little twist when you throw. Lamp oil, coal oil, kerosene layout, to be truant e.g., to lay out of school or lay out of work meeting, a gathering of people for religious purposes neri, nurani, nun pawlings, fence posts peckerwood, a disliked person piece, distance e.g., he'd have went up the road a piece to get on the main road piece, end snack. Plum or plum, completely e.g., son, you're plum crazy. Poke, n. brown paper bag poke salad, an a type of salad made from boiled greens usually pokeweed spelled variously solid, salad, and similar variations pokestock, polkstock, and a single shot shotgun, historically a rifle with an unusually long barrel popular with Kentucky frontiersmen pop, see coke above queer, queer totally unrelated to sexuality, strange, odd as in, he's sure a queer, un, reckon, suppose I reckon you don't like soup beans right smart, good deal of e.g., a right smart piece for, a long way, scald, n. poor land, bad land sigoglin, not built correctly, crooked, out of balance skift, dusting of snow slap, full, complete e.g., a fall in the river, which went slap right and straight down, smart, hardworking, work brickle, example, she's a smart woman, always a cleanin' and a seven and a cookin' fair, family. Sop, gravy springhouse, n. a building usually positioned over a stream used for refrigeration before the advent of refrigerators sugar tree, n. sugar maple tree swan, also swanee swear, declare to be true toboggan, n. a knit hat or toque, rarely used to describe a type of sled tote, v. to carry, carry tow sack, burlap sack whistle pig, n. groundhog yonder, yander, a directional adverb meaning distant from both the speaker and the listener e.g., look over yonder. Colloquialisms co, cola, Coca-Cola, but used in the same sense as coke above origins early theories regarding the origins of the Appalachian dialect tend to revolve around popular notions regarding the region's general isolation and the belief that the region is culturally static or homogeneous the tendency of Appalachian speakers to retain many aspects of their dialect for a generation or more after moving to large urban areas in the north and West suggests that Appalachian English is conservative rather than isolated beliefs about Appalachia's isolation led to the early suggestion that the dialect was a surviving relic of long-forgotten forms of English. The most enduring of these early theories suggested that the Appalachian dialect was a remnant of Elizabethan English, a theory popularized by Berea College president William Gottlieb Frost in the late 1800s. However, while Shakespearean words occasionally appear in Appalachian speech e.g., afeard, these occurrences are rare examples of archaic phrases include the use of might could for might be able to, the use of un with pronouns and adjectives e.g., youngin, the use of done as a helping verb e.g., we done finished it, and the use of words such as Irish, brickle, swan, and bottom land all of which were common in southern and central England in 17th and 18th centuries. The use of double negatives wasn't uncommon in England during the 17th and 18th centuries. The use of the a prefix e.g., a goin for going and the attachment of ed to certain verbs e.g., node, originated in South England. Some speech habits which can be traced back to the rural areas of southern and central England include the H retention e.g., hit for it, the use of the word right in the place of rather e.g., right cold, and the presence of words such as yonder. While the Scotch-Irish and English settlers had a strong influence on the Appalachian dialect, linguistic analyses suggest that Appalachian English developed as a distinctive dialect among English-speaking people in North America. The Appalachian dialect retains a number of speech patterns found in colonial American English but largely discarded in standard speech, such as r intrusion e.g., warsh for wash and a y sound in place of a on the end of certain words e.g., okri for okra. The Southern drawl is of an unknown American origin, although some suspect it originated in African American English. Much of Appalachian English has developed independently in the Appalachian region of North America, and is not a remnant of speech derived from the British Isles. However, most of that which can be traced to Europe does not in fact have its origins in either Scotland, Ireland, or Northern England. In fact, the majority of the linguistic anachronisms found in this region of North America can be traced back to regions of England such as the West Country, Southern England, and East Anglia. Native American influences in the Appalachian dialect are virtually non-existent, the exception being place names, e.g., Appalachia, Tennessee, Chattahoochee River, Choa Mountains. While early settlers adopted numerous customs from tribes such as the Cherokee and Shawnee, they typically applied existing words from their own languages to these customs. See also Appalachian American. Sources: O'Grady, William, Dobrovolsky, Michael, and Aronoff, Mark. Contemporary Linguistics, An Introduction, 2nd edition, New York, St. Martin's Press, 1993. LeBove, William, Ash, Sharon, Boberg, Charles, 2006, The Atlas of North American English, Berlin, Mouton de Gruyter, ISBN 1964. Carat, Montgomery, 1002-1004. Carat, LeBove, Ash. Carat, Wolfram and Christian, 58-59. Carat, Wolfram and Christian, 62. Carat, Montgomery, 1004. Carat, M.K.L. Ching, December 1996. Greasy, Greasy and Other, Z.S., Choices in Southern Pronunciation, PDF, Journal of English Linguistics, 24, 4-295-307. Doi, 101177, 0075424296024004-05. Carat, Wolfram and Christian, 72. Carat, Wolfram and Christian, 74. Carat, Wolfram and Christian, 73. Carat, Wolfram and Christian, 76. Carat, Wright, 59. Carat, Edward Everett Dale, The Speech of the Pioneers, The Arkansas Historical Quarterly, Volume 6, Number 2, Summer, 1947, pp. 117-131. Carat, A. B. Wolfram and Christian. Carat, Wolfram and Christian, 91. Carat, Montgomery, 1002-1003. Carat, Wolfram and Christian, 101-102. Carat, Montgomery, Encyclopedia of Appalachia, 1001-1003. Carat, A B C D E F G H I J. Montgomery, Encyclopedia of Appalachia, 1002. Carat, A B A. Form of the Older English phrase, era. The negative form is nary, not any. The A pronunciation of the archaic in era. Both are widely used in A when the word one follows. The W sound is dropped to form one word, arani, narani, when the word one is emphasized. However, the W sound returns ary one, nary one. Example, have you got any money? Reply, no, I hain't got nary penny. Have you got a rani? Contrary to a widespread myth current among non-A speakers, the word is not followed by the indefinite article, which in fact is built into it. See Richard H. Thornton, An American Glossary, Philadelphia and London, 1912, Volume 2, p. 601, available online at https://books.google.com/bookspring=pa565. Carat, Luann von Schneidmesser, Generic Names for Soft Drinks by County. Retrieved, 25 November 2008. Carat, Benjamin J. Kramer Collection, Archives of Appalachia. Carat, A. B. University of South Carolina, College of Arts and Science Dictionary, Southern Appalachian English. Retrieved, 20 March 2007. Dictionary, Southern Appalachian English, archived from the original on 24 September 2008. Retrieved 23 October 2008. Smoky Mountain Historical Society Newsletter 3, No. 4 September 1977, p. 8. Carat, http://newsnationalgeographic.com/news/2005/05/05052_05052_twang_2html. Carat, Fisher, 653. Carat, Davy Crockett, James Shackford, et al. Ed., A Narrative of the Life of David Crockett of the State of Tennessee. Knoxville, 10, University of Tennessee Press, 1973, 18. Carat, Smart, Southern U.S. Dialect, Glossary. The Dialect Dictionary, retrieved 4 December 2011. Carrot Montgomery, Encyclopedia of Appalachia, 1001. Carrot Montgomery, Michael, and Joseph S. Hall Dictionary of Smoky Mountain English, Knoxville, University of Tennessee Press, 2004. Carrot Montgomery, The Encyclopedia of Appalachia, 1002. Carrot Montgomery, How Scotch-Irish Is Your English, 22-27. Carrot Fisher, 654. Carrot Montgomery, How Scotch-Irish Is Your English, 28-29. Carrot Montgomery, The Encyclopedia of Appalachia, 1000-1001. Carrot Montgomery, How Scotch-Irish Is Your English, 21. Carrot Talking Appalachian, Voice, Identity, and Community, edited by Amy D. Clark, Nancy M. Hayward. Carrot https://books.google.com/books@OOU3BVVZ9HOC. External links. Christian, Donna, Walt Wolfram, Nanjo Dube, 1988. Variation and Change in Geographically Isolated Communities, Appalachian English and Ozark English, Tuscaloosa, Alabama, American Dialect Society, ISBN. England. Macam Mancunian Multicultural London. Norfolk Northern Pitmatic Potteries received pronunciation. Scouse Southern Suffolk Sussex West Country Mummerset West Midlands Yorkshire. Essex Norfolk Suffolk East Midlands North Cheshire Cumbria Lancashire Manchester Merseyside Sunderland Tyneside Yorkshire South Kent Thames Estuary, London Sussex West Country. Bristol Cornwall Dorset West Midlands Black Country Birmingham Stoke-on-Trent Northern Ireland Mid Ulster Ulster Scots Scotland Glasgow Highlands Lowlands Wales Cardiff Gower. Ireland Dublin D4 Southwest Cork Superregional Ulster Channel Islands Alderney Guernsey Jersey Elsewhere Gibraltar Isle of Man Malta North and South America United States. Midwestern New England New Mexican New York, Brooklynese, North Jersey New York Latino Old Southern Ozark Pacific Northwest Pennsylvania Dutch Philadelphia, South Jersey Pittsburghese Rhode Island Southern Texan Upper Midwestern Western Vermont Yacht. Yeshivish Upper. New York Latino North South Acadiana Appalachia Chesapeake, Pamlico Miami New Orleans Ozarks Texas West California New Mexico Pacific Northwest Western Pennsylvania Canada Aboriginal Atlantic